Gathered here today as part of the celebration of the historic centenary of the ANC, a short 4 years ahead of the related establishment of the University College of Forte in 1916. Understandably, as part of the celebration of its centenary, the ANC decided that it would devote particular months throughout the centenary year 2012 to give the opportunity to the nation to reflect on the contributions to the national cause, particularly of those of our patriots and compatriots who had served as its presidents. I'm very glad indeed that the University of Forte has decided to have this series of Oliver Tambo lectures. And accordingly, we meet here today because of this, to speak about one of these presidents of the ANC, the late Oliver Reginald Tambo, who, if he was still alive, would have celebrated his 95th birthday 8 days from today. I trust that you'll pardon me if I do not use this occasion to succumb to the natural temptation to present to you a truncated biography of Oliver Tambo, which you know. With your permission, given what I've said, I'll speak about Oliver Tambo in the context of the historic evolution of the ANC, and therefore the overall liberation movement of our country. However, before I reflect on this important matter, which is obviously relevant to the centenary of the ANC, I must say that I have prepared this lecture deeply troubled by a feeling of great unease that our beloved motherland is losing its sense of direction. And that we are allowing ourselves to progress towards a costly disaster of a protracted and endemic general crisis. Today, as we meet here at Forte, I for one am not certain about where our country and nation will be tomorrow. What I should do in this regard to respond to what is obviously a dangerous and unacceptable situation of unguided national drift. Among others, that feeling of unease is informed by questions I've not been able to answer about what happened which allowed the eminently avoidable massacre at the Lonmin Marikana mine in the Northwest Province to happen. Among others, this tragedy and its consequences seem to have signaled a radical weakening of the national labor relations system, which is one of the major victories of the National Democratic Revolution. The system is based on the fundamental propositions that the state should put in place the policies to help ensure a thriving economy and the equitable distribution of national wealth, and the system of industrial relations which would enable labor and capital to negotiate the specific agreements which would give practical expression to the objective of shared prosperity in the context of a growing economy. My feeling of unease is also informed by what I sense is a pervasive understanding throughout the nation that there is no certainty about our future with regard to any of our known challenges and therefore the future of the nation. This is underlined by a troubled, pessimistic sentiment among many families in our country about whether their children can expect a future better, contrary to the travails the parents of these young people had to endure, including students at this university. My sense of unease is also informed by the fears I know are shared by many throughout our continent, rightly or wrongly, that they face the threat that because of our internal conflicts, our country could lose its ability to defend its independence, to be an exemplar of resolute African assertion of our self-determination and African pride, as did Ethiopia during an earlier period of Africa's struggle for emancipation. And those fears derive from what the rest of Africa believes is a significant weakening of the binding assurance which our continent thought it had, that our country would at all times serve as one of the most important of the important continental anchors in defense of the right to self-determination of the peoples of Africa and African diaspora. I know that what I've just said might not sit easily in the minds and hearts of some circles here at home and abroad, which I would understand. However, I also know this is a matter of fact, that it will not be possible to correct whatever might have gone wrong and therefore address our challenges in this regard unless all of us have the honesty and courage publicly to state what we believe is true. In this context, I'm convinced that it would be a treacherous to hide our hands in the sand and behave as though we remain on course in terms of the achievement of our shared and various national objectives. Equally, of course, we must be ready to accept such criticism as might result from anything and everything that we say, ready to engage in a consequent, open debate, thus to engage in the processes for which I have constantly urged, borrowing on the task the great Chinese people set themselves to let 100 flowers bloom and 100 schools of thought to contend. Obviously, such an intellectual contest would have to be based on the firm understanding that those who control the levers of state power would not misuse such control to stifle or suppress any opinion, regardless of its content, but also would not remain silent when others willfully and recklessly abuse their right to freedom of thought and speech. So I must now return to my required and specific presentation to you about the role of Oliver Tambo in terms of our struggle for national liberation. This means that I must speak specifically about the strengthening of the organized formations of the movement and the movement whose actions ultimately brought about the political liberation of South Africa in 1994. I must also speak about the processes and struggles which resulted in that historic compromise of 94, which led to the general election of that year and which ended white minority rule in our country and effectively closed the centuries-old period of the colonial domination of Africa and the rest of the world. I must as well pay tribute to the broad liberation movement in our country, in the rest of Africa and the world, not only the ANC, as it engaged in the struggle to defeat the last, best resource, and most stubborn outpost of the global colonial system, apartheid South Africa. For over half a century, Oliver Tambo was a central actor in all these processes. And correctly to discuss the central thesis of my presentation, which I've indicated, I must say something about South Africa as it came to be defined by 3.5 centuries of imperialist and colonial domination. I've chosen to discuss its history briefly, because it is directly relevant both to our immediate subject of the role of Oliver Tambo in our struggle and the tasks we face today of the further advancement of the objectives of the National Democratic Revolution to which he dedicated his life. I'm certain that you understand very well that this is directly relevant to the historic challenge of all revolutionaries to fight for the revolutionary transformation of society, to create a new social order which would benefit the ordinary masses in all these societies. By definition and inevitably, revolution means that there must take place a titanic struggle for victory over each other and one another, between and among the forces representing the new and the forces seeking to preserve the old order. And logically, in pursuit of their respective and antagonistic outcomes, each of these contending forces would seek victory over each other in a zero-sum game. In this regard, I would like to believe that as thinking people committed to the progressive transformation of our country and continent, you will have made an effort to understand what have been described as revolutionary processes relating alternatively to our seminal year 1994 and what has been happening, for example, to the African country of Egypt since 2011. I'm certain that from both these processes, You'll have understood that the neat paradigm I have mentioned of the defeat of the old and the victory of the new is not necessarily correct in terms of what happens in actual life. Very often these forces, the old and the new, enter into unavoidable compromises which throw up their own challenges. But no revolution is worthy of its name if it does not know when to enter into such compromises and gets lost about what it should do afterwards in pursuit of its strategic goals. I say this to make the point that the political victory of 1994 represented such a compromise which dictated and dictates that the National Democratic Revolution should, while understanding that such compromise represents an important historical advance, nevertheless poses the challenge to answer the question about what it should do to continue to pursue its strategic goals. In this regard, with your permission, I'd like to quote a famous paragraph in a book by the eminent revolutionary that Tzilani said she never read Karl Marx, which explains some of the dialectical relationship between the new and the old. In his 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte, Marx said, "Men make their own history, but they do not make it as they please. They do not make it under self-selected circumstances, but under circumstances existing already, given and transmitted from the past. The tradition of all dead generations weighs like a nightmare on the brains of the living. And just as they seem to be occupied with revolutionizing themselves and things, creating something that did not exist before, precisely in such epochs of revolutionary crisis, they anxiously conjure up the spirits of the past to their service. And as they engaged in protracted struggle to make their own history, the masses of our people, who sacrificed everything for the victory of the strategic objective of the National Democratic Revolution, achieved this objective under circumstances existing already, given and transmitted from the past. And thus, as we and they were occupied with revolutionizing themselves and things, creating something that did not exist before, we and them had to take into account the reality we had inherited. And therefore, the political compromise of 1994 was born of this concrete and historical reality in which men do not make history as they please, which signifies both an historic and important advance and the definition of particular objective parameters within which the National Democratic Revolution would have to pursue its strategic objectives. In this regard, as Marx had indicated, the Democratic Revolution entered into agreements during the 1990-1994 negotiations, taking into account the conditions which Marx described as not being itself selected circumstances, but circumstances existing already. I would like to believe that it is obvious to all of us that the complex and challenging reality created by this actuality, which was obviously not unique to our country, would pose a particular challenge to our forces of revolution to develop the necessary strategy and tactics correctly to respond to this reality. In this regard, I'm convinced that our revolution was very fortunate, that it had the possibility to draw on the firm foundation which Oliver Tambo had helped to establish before he was suddenly and unexpectedly struck down by paralyzing affliction. Relating specifically to the contribution that Oliver Tambo made in this regard, I would not hesitate to underline the importance of the exercise of correct leadership at moments of revolutionary change. In this context, I have no hesitation in saying that Oliver Tambo was an outstanding revolutionary democrat, a principal theoretician of the perspective of the National Democratic Revolution to which ANC is committed, and consequently a central architect of the popular forces which would have an obligation to lead the offensive to achieve that national democratic revolution. I therefore like to thank the Vice Chancellor, Dr. Mbeki, the academic staff, ANC Youth League, students and workers, members of this university, for giving me the opportunity to speak here today at this inaugural lecture. I say this because I can think of no better location than this particular university dispassionately to discuss the historic significance of Oliver Tambo's contribution to the realization of the vision that we share of building a better life for all. I'm also certain that you will realize that what I've just said constitutes a particular challenge to you who have followed in the footsteps voluntarily to become members of the Center of Learning and Inquiry, the outstanding historic incubator in our country of many revolutionary democrats and fighters for African liberation like Oliver Tambo, from our country and from many other countries in Southern and East Africa. In this context, I believe that we who have gathered here today have no choice but to ask ourselves the vitally important question: what are we doing today during these challenging times for the future of South Africa and Africa to ensure that Fort Hare University continues to be that incubator of Africa's revolutionary democrats and a center for the promotion of the objective of the Renaissance of Africa, which characterized so distinctively the life of Oliver Tambo? That's why I return to what I said earlier about the imperative to speak even briefly about South Africa as it came to be defined by the 3.5 centuries of colonialism and imperialist domination. I say this because I'm convinced that the historical processes which produced that outcome dictated the task of our national liberation movement. And therefore the ANC must continue to this day and continue to be informed by that outcome in order to address the matter of the central agenda of the National Democratic Revolution. In this context, you would have heard the regular refrain repeated constantly by influential voices in our country and abroad, including through our domestic media, that Oliver Tambo's movement, the ANC, after 18 years as our country's ruling party, has no right to blame our current reality on our colonial and apartheid past. The firm assertion is made that certainly since 1994, what South Africa came from, became from then onwards, was a unique creation of the policies and programs of the African National Congress. This assertion seeks to advance the self-serving political proposition that the 1994 political victory wiped out our country's colonial and apartheid socio-economic slate clean, giving the ANC the unfettered freedom to inscribe its own characters on this alleged blank slate, to borrow language that was used during the Maoist years in China. In this respect, I can refer to countless occasions when in the past I said that the central and immediate task of the National Democratic Revolution after the political victory of 1994 was to dismantle the legacy of colonialism and apartheid. And this evoked major opposition on the basis of the strange and false argument that the apartheid legacy died in 1994. But what is this colonial and apartheid heritage? Among others, colonialism and apartheid have meant that democratic South Africa has inherited the legacy of the impact of the most pervasive colonial and imperialist system in terms of the dispossession of the indigenous African majority, and the destruction of its communities, resulting in deculturation, the radical weakening of any sense of African identity, and the destruction of the traditional value system identified as Ubuntu, Butu, which would ensure African social cohesion. It's also represented by the imposition of a capitalist system of property relations across the board, originally exclusively for the benefit of the white minority, which has nevertheless educated our entire population both black and white, to accept the capitalist value system as the only relevant value system which should inform all social behavior. It has meant a related culture of violence based on the notion of individual benefit at all costs, and born in part from the absence of a value system and state practice militating against such violence, and the practice of state structures in the past to resort to violence to sustain the oppressive colonial and apartheid system. It has meant a predominantly landless, propertyless, and unskilled African majority, constituting more than 75% of our population, which depends for its livelihood on employment in the public and private sectors, but much of which is unemployable because it does not have the skills required by a modern economy and society. It has also resulted in an educational system that was consciously designed to produce an African majority which would have no skills and impetus to enable it to carry out more than clerical and manual tasks. It's also been marked by the absence of a rural peasantry with access to land steeped in peasant productive culture, having the means and capable of sustaining even subsistence peasant farming, and therefore representing a significant section of the indigenous majority capable of acting independently. It has also meant the creation of an entrenched social order of privilege and power, characterized in the main by an essentially three-layered hierarchy of racial divisions. And given the foregoing, the construction of South Africa as a state built in all respects as a racist entity of defined unequal racial communities, and the later systematic insertion into this by the apartheid regime of ethnic identities and divisions among the African people. And it has meant the positioning of South Africa then as an economic outpost of the developed Western world, and therefore a producer and exporter of precious minerals and raw materials, and an importer of manufactured goods. And it has meant the position of South Africa as other than an African country, arguing that it occupies a special place, space, as the exemplar of modern human development within a pre-modern and regressive African continent. The imperialist and colonial reality we have just sought to describe was accompanied and sustained as was necessary by forcible and exclusive white minority rule. It is therefore obvious that necessarily the ANC as a credible organization of the African oppressed, even before Oliver Tambo joined it, had no choice but to strive for the reconstruction of South Africa away from the paradigm representative and characteristic of South African colonial reality, which colonialism, the South African Communist Party 50 years ago, correctly characterized as colonialism of a special type. Accordingly and correctly, from the time of its foundation, the ANC set itself the task to end colonial and white minority rule in our country, and indeed in our region, and therefore to transform South Africa into a non-racial democracy. It would therefore be correct to say that this was the first strategic task of the National Democratic Revolution, which the ANC pursued up to the historic political victory of 1994. I would insist that the second strategic task of the National Democratic Revolution in our country, consequence upon that political victory of 1994, is the eradication of the legacy of colonialism and apartheid. And I would also insist that the third strategic task of our revolution is the entrenchment of a national democratic society, focused on ensuring the permanence of the genuinely democratic, non-racial, non-sexist, and prosperous society visualized in our constitution, which would define the long-term character of South Africa as a truly egalitarian society. Earlier, I referred to the historic challenge that faces all revolutionaries to fight for the fundamental transformation of society, to create a new social order which would benefit the ordinary masses in all these societies. And that challenge of revolutionary transformation has faced and will face the National Democratic Revolution as it has and will confront all three of the tasks that I've mentioned. It must follow from what I've said that I must now return to the matter of the tasks of the NDR and Oliver Tambo's role in this regard. In this context, I'd like to say a few more words about Oliver Tambo to help to explain his role to which I have referred. Oliver Tambo belonged among a cadre of intellectuals and professionals who passed through the portals of this university, and yet others, including those who came from the ranks of the trade union movement, the traditional African faiths, the Christian churches, the Muslim mosques, the Judaic synagogues, who discharged their responsibility brilliantly as leaders and activists of our revolution. Like some or many among these, what distinguished Oliver Tambo are an unwavering commitment to serve the people of South Africa with no expectation of any personal benefit. And this affirmed the value system at the center of which is respect for the fundamental principle and practice that leaders are there to serve the people. What also distinguished him was a sustained determination to conduct himself in his personal life so that at all times he would never betray the ethical standards which the masses he represented and led viewed as fundamental to their definition of themselves. He was characterized by the commitment to its full extent of the entirety of his enormous intellectual capacity and personal energy to pursue the objectives of the revolution. His ability as an outstanding strategist to lead the broad forces of the National Democratic Revolution through the twists and turns of an ever-changing and therefore dynamic national, continental, and international situation, ensuring that the revolution did not lose its focus on its fundamental goals. He had the flexibility of a master tactician, requiring the necessary command of detail, which enabled him correctly to identify the tactical maneuvering which would be imperative to sustain the advance of the democratic revolution towards its victory. He had great capacity to communicate well thought out, clear, and relevant messages to the National Democratic Movement as a whole about its tasks at all times, which reassured everybody that there was purpose to their actions and a positive end game to their sacrifices. He had great ability to ensure the cohesion of the forces of the revolution by taking all the necessary steps, including though through even his personal interaction with the people constituting his masses, which reinforced the confidence of these forces in the apex leadership of the revolution, which strengthened their will and capacity to act as one cohesive force. I'm certain that all of you present here will have understood that what I've just said about Oliver Tambo describes exactly the kind of leadership that any period of revolutionary change needs. I've said what I've said about Oliver Tambo to reflect on the kind of person he was, which I would like to believe underlines how rare a leader of the National Democratic Revolution he was, precisely and specifically as such a revolutionary leader. I must also state this frankly, that I thought it important to state what I believe set Oliver Tambo apart as a leader he was, to underline the fundamental point that unless we produce other leaders and cadres of the caliber of Oliver Tambo, it is almost inevitable that the National Democratic Revolution will fail. Everything I've said surely emphasizes the reality that the revolution continues and therefore demands a leadership linked to the masses of the people that is capable of leading this revolution, exemplified by what Oliver Tambo achieved in this regard. I think we must therefore ask ourselves the difficult questions. Question whether yesterday the democratic revolution produced and has produced a caliber of leadership exemplified by Oliver Tambo. And therefore, whether we, who directly inherited the Tambo legacy, lived up to the demands of that legacy, which I trust will help to explain the grave challenges that we face. In his famous play Hamlet, in the eminent English playwright William Shakespeare that Zelani talked about, reflecting on similarly troubled times in his imagined state of Denmark, got his hero Hamlet to utter the challenging words full of pathos that the time is out of joint, O cursed spite that ever was born to set it right. I dare say that the time during which we live is out of joint. The challenge each one of us faces is whether we have the courage to set it right. And centuries after Shakespeare lived and composed his plays, early in the 20th century, the Irish poet W.B. Yeats foresaw an epoch when the time would be out of joint for all humanity. And in his famous poem, The Second Coming, he wrote that the darkness drops again, but now I know that 20 centuries of stony sleep were vexed to nightmare by a rocking cradle. And what rough beast is our come round at last, slouches towards Bethlehem to be born. And during the same century, the last, our own undeclared national poet laureate, S.E.K.M.K.R.I., foresaw similar times for our country and wrote the disturbing words in one of our own languages, Kunamhlanje ilizwe liyazuza, Kunamhlanje lo mhlaba uyalunywa, Into esesiswini mazineyilumkele, Loo nto isesizalweni mazineyindwebele, Namhla ngathi kuza kuzala ugilikanko, Ngathi kuza kuzala isilo esingaziwa mngxuma. Surely our own consciousness and consciences as revolutionary democrats must tell us that we would honor Oliver Tambo best, not by finding flattering and casual words to speak well of him, but by responding correctly to a time that is out of joint, by confronting the beast that is slouching out of Bethlehem to be born, by contending with Isilo Esingaziwanga, the frightening beast of the wild of no known abode and origin. I can think of no better response to these historic challenges to guarantee our victory over human deprivation and the dehumanization of the African than to do what we must to emulate the example that Oliver Tambo set, which helped to define what the ANC must be. And thank you very much for your attention.